Okay, if you're out there, we're testing right now to see if we got everybody. We did have the wrong date posted, I guess, on the WebEx site, so we're waiting a little bit to make sure we got everybody. Could somebody tell me that we got volume out there? I'm gonna make the chat box bigger. All right, good. Thank you very much, Gail. All right, I'm going to share my desktop today. So this is the first for WebEx. There we go. All right. We're starting in about 4 minutes. 4 minutes. Not letting me show you the best. All right, we're going to get started here. We're going to... There we go. All right. Welcome to SunMax Solar, a series of webinars. Today's topic is finding roof orientation. And I know when I first came to the solar thermal field, this was a point of confusion for me. And I noticed from talking around that it was a point of confusion for several people that I talked to. And I know of some serious mistakes being made when it came to typing the right numbers into Red Screen and T-Saw. So I figured I'd do a topic, a webinar on that. So I think I've got it straight in my mind. Hopefully I can get it straight in your mind after we're done here. Finding roof orientation. Now we're going to start very, very basic here with a compass. All right, and since I'm going to have to answer all my own questions here, you can get the answers in your head before I answer them myself. And we'll start with something very basic. I used to ask my students, you know, what are the directions on a compass? And you'd be surprised how many didn't know. What direction does a compass needle point? Well, obviously it points to the north. All right, now where are the rest of the directions? Okay, what's over here? Stop. That's east. Okay, down here. We got south. Over here we got west. Very, very basic. Now, harder question. What numerical designation does north have on a compass? Zero. All right. Do the numbers on a compass increase clockwise or counterclockwise? The answer is clockwise. And there is your typical compass. All right. Let's say we got a roof that's oriented in that direction right there. Now, every one of these blue marks is worth 10 degrees. Okay, so get a number in your head. What is the compass bearing on that roof? If you said 210 degrees, you would be right. Now, in any other field, 210 degrees is the azimuth of that roof. Any other field. But if you punch that number into Red Screen or T-Saw, you will be completely and totally wrong. Okay? So don't do that. Okay? It's not that simple. Because the solar thermal industry treats azimuth a little bit differently than most other fields. Okay? So let's start over again here. Now, what direction do we care about in the solar industry? We care about south, because that's where the sun is at solar noon. And on average, if you point your panels in that direction, that's where you will get the best average insulation during the day. So we care about true south. All right, so we really want to know how far the roof is off of true south. And if that reading was 210 degrees and true south is 180 degrees, we can just subtract 210 minus 180, and that is 30 degrees. Okay, 30 degrees off of true south, and that is the number that you would want to put into Red Screen or T-Saw. Okay, how do we get that again? Okay, we took our compass bearing, minus 180 degrees, which is south. That equals 30 degrees. All right? So what we're really talking about here is relative azimuth. We're not talking about azimuth. We're talking relative azimuth. And I wish they would change the wording in Red Screen and T-Saw to reflect that. It'd make things a lot less confusing. Okay, but that's what it really is. When you punch that number in, you want the relative azimuth, or the azimuth relative to true south. All right. Now what if we have a roof that's pointing in that direction? You'll notice that's also 30 degrees off of true south. But it does make a difference whether you're getting the morning sun or the afternoon sun. Okay, so it would make a difference in the production during the day. So we don't want to flip the same thing. But if you look at the numbers here, the numbers are decreasing. There's 170, 160, 150. All right, so if the numbers are decreasing there, this is a negative difference, so that would be negative 30 degrees. Does that mean we have to figure it out in a different way? No, we could do it exactly the same way. It's 150 degrees, the compass bearing, minus 180 degrees, true south, okay, and that gives us negative 30 degrees. So, any numbers, okay, any compass bearings that are west of true south are positive relative azimuths. And any compass bearings that are east of true south are negative compass bearings. Okay? So what would true south be? Well, 180 degrees minus 180 degrees is zero. So in the solar fields, all right, 0 degrees is south, okay? And we have positive numbers to the west, negative numbers to the east, okay? So let's review. What's the formula? Relative azimuth, the number that you would punch into T-solar retching, equals compass bearing minus 180 degrees. All right, and that's all there is to it, right? Very simple. Not quite. All right, first of all, there's some people out there who have never used a compass. All right, I'm not going to teach you how to use a compass today, but there are, let's see, websites that can do that. There's a website right here that teaches you how to use a compass. All right. Or you can ask a Boy Scout, and they can teach you how to use a compass. All right, another thing is, what can affect the performance of a compass? Well, it turns out anything that's magnetic or iron, okay, can affect the performance of that compass. This could be something as simple as a wristwatch on your hand or a nail in the roof, okay? Anything that's magnetic, anything that has iron in it, or anything with an electric current running through a wire, because anytime an electric current runs through a wire, that creates a magnetic field, and that's going to affect your compass. So you do have to be careful when you are using a compass. And the last point I have to bring up here, a very important point, certainly not least, does a compass point to true north? And it turns out it does not. Okay? It does not. Now, everybody knows the world turns. Okay, it spins around on an axis. So, what exactly is true north? Okay, well, what's the North Pole? What's the South Pole? The North Pole and South Pole are the points where our Earth's imaginary axis would come sticking up out of the Earth. That's where the North Pole and the South Pole are. Okay, so if we stuck a stick right through this, okay, at the points where it's turning, okay, that stick would come out at the North Pole and the South Pole. And this shows a diagram of the Earth, and those lines are part of our latitude-longitude system. Those are longitude lines, okay, and they meet at the North and South Pole. So there is the true North Pole. Those lines are true north-south lines, and they are perfectly straight, okay, around the surface of the Earth. Okay, so if that's North Pole, is that where a compass points? No, it does not. All right, so where does the compass point? It points to the magnetic North Pole. And here's a diagram, a little experiment you may remember from elementary school or middle school. Okay, where you put a bar magnet underneath a piece of paper and then put iron filings on top and shake the piece of paper around, and you get a pretty good representation of what the magnetic field looks like. Well, that's sort of what the Earth looks like, too, because the Earth has its own magnetic field. And there is a diagram representation of the Earth's magnetic field. Why does the Earth have a magnetic field? Well, there's a theory that has to do with the liquid iron in the outer core going around in convection currents combined with the kinetic energy from the spinning Earth, and that gives us a magnetic field here. I don't need to go into the details of that for you to understand this, but the Earth does have a magnetic field, and those magnetic field lines are the things that a compass aligns itself with. All right? Only this is a closer reality to what our magnetic field really looks like, and you can see it's a lot messier than that diagram. This is, I believe, a NASA supercomputer image figuring out like what our magnetic field would be. And it's a really nice picture, but it's a heck of a lot messier than that ideal one we just looked at. And since the liquids are constantly sloshing around inside the Earth, the Earth's magnetic field constantly changes. And these are representations of what the magnetic field lines would look on the surface. And you notice, if you look very carefully, they're not straight lines. They curve. Alright, and they can be disrupted locally by things like magnetite deposits and iron ore. And so you do have to have an idea about these magnetic field lines, because these are the lines that your compass is lining up with. And that point that you see right there is the magnetic North Pole. And this diagram, this map, shows a plotting of the magnetic North Pole over the course of time. You notice that it does change position. This is where it is approximately in 2011. And is that where the true North Pole is? No, it's not. All right, you can see where the meridians come together. There is the true North Pole. So let's take a view on a different map here. Let's go bigger, zoom out, and take two positions, one on the East Coast, one on the West Coast. And let's draw a line from a position on the East Coast to the true North Pole. Now that is true north. Okay, now this is a little bit simplified. The line should really curve along the surface, but for demonstration's sake, we're just going to make it a straight line. Now, if you take out your compass on the East Coast, is that where your compass is going to point? No, it's not. It's going to point there, which is actually west of true north. All right? If we're on the West Coast, there's true north. Is that where our compass is going to point? No. It's going to point there, which is east of true north. So if you want to find true north and you've got a compass, you need to know that difference. So let's go to a diagram here, and let's say that's true north. Let's go back to our compass, little compass basics here. Put our directions on. This direction is east, down here, south, down here, west. All right, let's say our compass is pointing right there. Magnetic north is right there. All right, now that is exaggerated a little for the purposes of our demonstration here. All right, so numerically, what is true north on a compass? Zero. Okay, zero. Right there. And this line is east of true north. Okay, the numbers on a compass increase clockwise or counterclockwise. What is it? Clockwise. Okay, so this is a positive difference right there. A positive what? A positive magnetic declination. So, what coast are we on here? We're on the West Coast. Okay, we're on the West Coast. So, everybody on the West Coast has a positive magnetic declination. Okay? All right, magnetic north is right there. Magnetic north is west of true north. What coast are we on now? We're on the East Coast. Okay? But now we're going in this direction. We're going counterclockwise. Zero would be the same as 360, so the numbers would be decreasing, so that is a negative magnetic declination. All right, so if you want to find your true readings and all you have is a compass, okay, then you need to know the magnetic declination at your location. Where are you going to find the magnetic declination? A magnetic declination map is one good place. And you'll notice everybody over here east of the Mississippi has negative numbers, okay? And everybody over here west of the Mississippi has positive numbers, okay? And if you happen to live right on the Mississippi River, you don't have to worry about magnetic declination. You just have to worry about major floods. Where else can you find your magnetic declination? Well, here's one spot, NOAA, the National Oceanic and Atmospheric Administration. Just type in your zip code of your location. I'll type in Binghamton's here, one of Binghamton's. And you just hit get location. And that tells you your latitude and longitude. You can even put in the year you want the present and compute your declination. And it gives us 12 degrees, 25 minutes. For those of you not familiar with minutes, there are 60 minutes in a degree. So that's about 12 and a half degrees west. Okay, and if you remember the graphic, if the declination is, the magnetic north is west of true north, It's negative. So this would be negative 12 and a half degrees magnetic declination. All right. Now let's use a real life example of a person who made a mistake with magnetic declination. It turned out it wasn't a disaster, but it ended up not being what he wanted to do, and we're going to look at it from the point of view of God. All right? So we are going to know where true north is, but the man who was doing this calculation did not. So there's true north right there. Now, once again, we're looking at it from God's point of view. All right, the man with the compass doesn't know this. What he did know was the magnetic declination at his location was minus 13 degrees, negative 13 degrees. He knew that, and he had his handy-dandy compass. So, armed with the magnetic declination, and he let his compass go, and that's where the needle ended up. So that was magnetic north. So he knows that's magnetic north, because that's what his compass tells him, and he knows the magnetic declination is negative 13 degrees. He does not know this is true north. He doesn't know where true north is. What he does now know is that is magnetic south. Now, in his head, he figured, okay, I got the magnetic declination, negative 13 degrees. I want to orient my new solar house true south. So, since the magnetic declination is negative 13 degrees, I am going to subtract 13 degrees from magnetic south. And that's where he pointed the foundation of his house, right there. And it turns out that's not what he wanted to do, because that's true south. So he was actually 26 degrees off of true south because he misunderstood how to use magnetic declination. All right, and that house is built in that direction today. Not a total disaster. He still gets a good percentage of the solar fraction. All right, but it's not what he originally intended to do. So we should figure out what we have to do with magnetic declination. In this case, he should have added, okay, 13 degrees, and he would have ended up with his house oriented true south. All right, so how are we going to avoid that? Well, if you remember our formula from before, relative azimuth, the number you want to stick in T-solar red screen, equals compass bearing minus 180 degrees. All right. What if you have a compass bearing? All right. Well, you got to take into account magnetic declination. So it'd be relative azimuth equals compass bearing minus 180 degrees minus the magnetic declination. Okay. If you have a negative magnetic declination, you have minus a negative number, which gives you a positive. All right, and you'd add it instead. So if he had used this formula, he would have actually pointed his house true south. All right, so if you are using a compass, find out your magnetic declination, find out your compass bearing, and then use this formula. Relative azimuth equals compass bearing minus 180 degrees, minus the magnetic declination of that location. Now, let's go back to the first formula, because if you have a smartphone, you can avoid magnetic declination completely. If you have a smartphone, you can get an app for it, a compass app. And if you look in the menu of that app, there will be a choice between magnetic north and true north. If you choose true north, you can forget all about magnetic declination, and you can just use the first formula. Relative azimuth equals compass bearing minus 180 degrees. Why can you do that? Because your smartphone works with the GPS, and GPS readings are based on satellites, not magnetic field lines. Okay, so therefore you can do the same thing with the GPS. Just use the first formula, because you will have a true compass bearing. Relative azimuth equals compass bearing minus 180 degrees. But if you're like me, and you got a phone that just makes phone calls, then you have to use a compass, all right? And you have to use the second formula, which is compass bearing minus 180 degrees minus the magnetic declination. All right, now let's say you're not out in the field. You're sitting at your desk. There are a couple of different tools to find your azimuth, roof ray, And Solmetric also has an azimuth tool. They work very similarly, so I'm actually going to use Google Chrome instead of Firefox, because sometimes Firefox has a little trouble with those two things. You may want to pick an alternative browser if you use Firefox normally, if you're going to use one of these. All right. In Solmetric site, you just go under support and go right to their roof azimuth tool, and then you type in your address. And then hit find. And there. Unfortunately, you can't zoom in any closer than that, but let's say I want to put solar panels right there on that section of the roof, okay, which tilts that way. I happen to know this house. All right, so I'll go up here, and I'll hit azimuth tool, and I'll go like that, and then I can stretch this, and I can put it in the direction that I think is perpendicular to that roof, and go like that. And that gives me an azimuth of 209 degrees about. Now, it does say azimuth, doesn't it? And it also says azimuth in T-Sol and Retscreen. If you put that number into T-Sol and Retscreen, you will be completely and totally wrong. That is the azimuth of the house, but Retscreen and T-Sol do not want the true azimuth, they want the relative azimuth, or azimuth relative to true south. Alright, so you need to use the formula. Since this is a true compass bearing, not a magnetic one, we can do compass bearing minus 180 degrees, so 209 degrees minus 180 degrees, and the number that we would put into T-Sol is 29 degrees. That's a positive number, okay, because it is west of true south. So 29 degrees is the number that would go into T-Sol or Retscreen for this particular house. And that's how you use the roof azimuth tool on the Solmetric site, and it's very similar for roof ray. And that concludes my webinar today, but I would like to promote a webinar series that we are starting tomorrow, and that's Sizing Solar Thermal Domestic Hot Water Systems, okay, brought to you by SunMax Solar, and this is a pay-per-view type of service, $15. It will cost per session, and Justin Martin, our solar thermal technician, will be doing this series for you. All right, and that does start tomorrow, so go to our website to get more information about that series. Thank you very much for your participation today. If you have any questions, since I haven't been able to see the chat, please email me at education@sunmaxsolar.com. Thank you very much.